بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين. Welcome to another episode of Wisdom from the Noble Quran. We were discussing Surah Yaseen and we came to the verse إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. As-sirat al-mustaqim is something which has been defined and described in the Quran, in other verses. And I think, as I mentioned before, if we follow this method of explaining Quranic verses by other Quranic verses, we will be on the safe side. At the end of Surah Shura, we have that وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ صراط الله الذي له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض ألا إلى الله تصير الأمور. You guide to the right path, the path of Allah, for whom to whom belongs any everything in the heavens and in the earth. So the Sirat al-Mustaqim is something which leads us. God has actually planned it for us to lead us to our destination, to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, it means going back to his reward, to his neighborhood in paradise. So this is Sirat al-Mustaqim. Now, we are Muslims, we have the book. Are we guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim? It depends how we take the book. That is very important. Are the Jews not guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim? Of course they are, because they are. They have the Torah, Allah has given them the book. It's mentioned in other places in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى وَهَارُونَ الْفُرْقَانَ وَضِيَاءً وَذِكْرًا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So Torah was Furqan. It's actually clarified between right and wrong. It was light, riya, it was dhikr, it was reminder. So they were given the book and they were guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim. Were not the Christians guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim? Of course they were guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim. Now, do we regard everyone who's given the book that they are guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim, or the guidance comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the book comes from Allah? Depending how we take that book, how we follow that book, we are either on Sirat al-Mustaqim or not on Sirat al-Mustaqim. So there are certain people that by the help of the book are guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim. And this is what we Muslims continuously say in our prayers. Although we are given the book, although we are following the Prophet, peace be upon him, although we believe in all tenets of Islam, in all tenets of faith, however, continuously you ask God, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, guide us to the right path. It seems, with the dua that we are making every day, that this is something that God has helped us to find in his guidance, the way we take the book. يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة. Oh, Yahya, take the book with force, with power, with resolve. That is how people are guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim. So, in Surah Hamd, when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every day, اهدنَا الصراط المستقيم, guide us to the right path. Then there is a description of that. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, the path of those upon whom you have bestowed your favor. غير المغضوب عليهم, not those to whom you gave the book, you gave the guidance, then you put your wrath on them. ولا الظالمين, and not those to whom you gave the guidance, you gave the book, but they went astray. So we may have the book, we may have been guided to the right path. However, we may act in a way that we bring the wrath of God upon ourselves. Or we may act in a way, we may take the book in a way that we may go astray. Now, who are these upon whom the favor of Allah is bestowed, that Allah has given them His favors? This is again described in another verse in the Quran. As I said, we can find the meanings of things in other verses. Al-Qur'anu yufassiru ba'duhu ba'dha, as we have in the general statement of most early mufassirin from both Sunni and Shia, that they were of this idea that Quran explains itself. Now, if we come to Surah Nisa, verse number 69. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. Whoever obeys God and the Prophet. Obeying God means obeying the Quran. Obeying the Prophet means obeying the Sunnah of the Prophet. Whatever he says, we should not differentiate between what is revealed to the Prophet in terms of Quran and what he says in terms of his own opinion or his own wisdom. Because Allah is asking us to obey the Quran and the Prophet, both what is revealed in the Quran and what is coming from the wisdom of the Prophet, peace be upon him. So, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولُ, whoever obeys God and the Messenger, they will be with those upon whom I have bestowed my favor. And these are Nabiyeen, the prophets, Siddiqeen, the truthful ones, Washuhada, the witnesses, Wassalihin, and the righteous ones. Of course, those who are in the category of the Muqarrabun, as we discussed before. So, continuously we are asking Allah to guide us to the path of these highly stationed people in spirituality. Now, here, what Surah Yaseen is telling, giving us, the information is giving us, is that, and of course the addressee is the Prophet, peace be upon him, إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, you are from the Mursaleen. Mursaleen are chosen members among the Nabiyeen. Nabiyeen are those who are given some sort of revelation, guidance, wisdom. They can guide themselves, they can guide others. But when Allah gives them some mission, then they become from Mursaleen. They are messengers, they are ambassadors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, we have in one hadith the number of the prophets, Nabiyeen, were 124,000. This is a hadith which is famous. The prophet gave this information to Abu Zar rahmatullah alayh, that the number of the prophets were 124,000. Among them, there were 313 messengers, the Mursaleen. So the prophet is one of them. Innaka lamin al-Mursaleen. Okay, what is your mission? Ala siratan mustaqim. You are sent to bring people to siratan mustaqim. You are a messenger on the right path, and you bring people to the right path, of course, if they follow you. The Prophet cannot force people to follow him. The only thing is that he can warn and he can give good news. So you are on Siratul Mustaqim, innaka lamin al-mursaleen, ala Siratul Mustaqim. You are on the right path. And anyone who follows you would be on the right path, as it's mentioned in Surah Shura, at the end of Surah Shura, وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. You guide towards the right path. And this right path is صِرَاطِ اللَّهِ. This is the path of Allah. الَّذِي لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Okay, this book, Yasin, والقرآن الحكيم, إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. How have you become from Mursaleen? Because of a revelation which has come down to you. تنزيل العزيز الرحيم. This is sending down. This is something which has been sent down from the Almighty, the All-Merciful. تنزيل العزيز الرحيم. So you are one of the Mursaleen. you are on the right path, while this is sending down from Azizur Rahim. Now, Tanzil means, of course, sending down, as I mentioned. It may mean, we may say, revelation, but literally it means to send down gradually, as some scholars of etymology say. So it means to send down. Now, does God have directions? Can we attribute directions to God, that he's up there and we are down here, and therefore he sends down things? There are certain Muslim scholars, there were in the past, there are now as well, who are actually of the view that, yes, God is in the heavens, in the skies, in the upper direction. He is up there, we are down here. He's sitting on the throne up there, and we are, of course, on the earth here. And they bring many examples, a sort of metamorphism, that a sort of anthropomorphism, that God is like a human being having occupying a space, and then, of course, that space is high, is up there, sublime, and we are down here, and things come down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, we know that the Mu'tazili scholars among the Sunni scholars and the Shi'i scholars, of course, they cannot allow such a thing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has no direction, no physical attribute, does not fill any space, because he is the creator of the space. Before he created heavens and the earth, where was he? Of course, he is the creator of the space, he is the creator of time. You cannot say before or after for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a nonsensical question. And you cannot say where is he, because this, again, another nonsensical question. He has created where, actually? He has created a space. So when we talk about God sending things down, it is not the physical aspect, the spatial aspect of this is not meant. We have to realize that by our wisdom, by our understanding. Of course, many things in the Quran we have to understand by our rational, judicious understanding, by our intellect, that it is completely understood, especially from other verses of the Quran as well, that God cannot have physical aspect. If he has physical aspect, then who has created that physical aspect? And if he is in a place, where was that place before he created that place? Has he created that place, or that place has been with him since eternity? You know, these are the things that we can think about. Of course, we leave these issues to theology. However, when we say God sends down, it means he dilutes. It's in terms of rank. It's not in terms of space or place. When God sends down things to us, it means he dilutes it in its rank so that you can catch it, you can understand it, you can use it. Otherwise, when things go up in terms of rank, of course, that would be a different world. وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا عِنْدَنَا خَزَائِنُهُ وَمَا نُنَزِّلُهُ إِلَّا بِقَدَرٍ مَعْلُومٍ. The treasures of everything, the stores of everything are with us. But there is no measure there. When we send it down, it finds measure, it finds dimension and these things, and we send it on, of course, with a measured amount. When it comes to this world, it finds a measured account. There, things never finish. Here, things finish. In that realm, in that rank, مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَعْدُ. Whatever is with you would finish, whatever is with Allah would remain, never finishes. That خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ never finishes, because there is no measurement there. Inshallah, when we go to paradise, we would get some idea of how these things mean. We cannot get the idea of unmeasured things which have no amount. And this is something which our mind, which is totally framed in this type of creation, cannot understand. Now, when Allah says Tanzil, it doesn't mean that it was somewhere high in the heavens or in the sky and it came down. It means its rank was reduced. It was diluted in a way that you can understand it. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Hamim wal kitab al-mubin. Inna ja'alnahu Qur'anan Arabiyan la'allakum ta'qilun. We have made this book a book in a spoken language, of course, language of the Prophet, Quran and Arabian, so that you understand it. However, if you want to come high where this book was initially and came down, diluted, reduced, وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا لَعَلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. When it is with us in Ummul Kitab, mother of the books, which probably, inshallah, we'll talk about it later, then it is so sublime, so wise, beyond your wisdom, beyond your grasp, beyond your concepts. So this tanzil is reducing these meanings so that you can understand it. So tanzil al-aziz al-rahim. This is the reduction, so to speak, the dilution, bringing down of those meanings by Al-Aziz Ar-Rahim. Mighty, this combination of Aziz Ar-Rahim has been used in many places in the Quran. As for example, in Surah Shu'ara, it's repeatedly mentioned, وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah is mighty, is merciful. Now, why this combination is used here, Tanzil al-Aziz al-Rahim, not any other combination? Probably it means that, of course, he has mercy upon you, but he's so mighty that he doesn't need to have mercy upon you. Sometimes, you know, we need to have mercy upon someone else to satisfy ourselves. We have need to have mercy upon ourselves to fulfill certain needs in ourselves. But this doesn't actually apply in the case of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is mighty. He is without any need. The only thing is that aspect of rahmah is bringing this down for human beings to be guided, to go towards him. Don't think that he needs to have this mercy upon you. And of course, although from the other way, going from end to the beginning, he's very merciful, but beware, he's very mighty too. I mean, don't think that his mercy would somehow thwart his might, or his might would ever thwart his mercy. Of course, his combination of conflicting qualities, which if it wants to come into one human being, it is not possible. Now, what is the purpose of revelation of this book? لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. So that you warn people whose fathers were not warned. So they were oblivious. They were in neglect of these meanings. Now, the duty of the Prophet is to give warning and to give good news. Bashara and Inzar. Bashiran wa Nadhira. He gives good news and he warns. Of course, good news means that human beings should not think that he's alone in this world. We should not think that our life ends with death. We should have hope for future, and we should work with that hope. Actually, if there was not that Bashara, that good news coming to us, they wouldn't have had much instigation to act in a way that we act while we have that good news and Bashara. Warning is when, of course, we are not behaving in a way which leads us to our safely to our final destination. And therefore, Inzar is out of mercy. I mean, if you see someone is going astray, if you don't tell them anything, this is meanness, isn't it? Sometimes we think that when Allah talks about Inzar, she is angry or he is somehow he wants to punish us or to put us in trouble. That is not the case. Enzar is when someone feels for someone else. When you see a blind person passing through the street and a car is coming, you want to warn them. If you don't warn them, you have no feeling and you have no humanity if you don't do that. And therefore, Enzar, and this is repeatedly mentioned in the Quran, comes out of Allah's mercy, Allah's care. I mean, those who go away from God, those who absolutely forget Him, those who absolutely go against His will, He warns them. Why should He warn them? Why should He care at all to warn these people? It comes out of His mercy. So this tanzir, letunzira, so that you warn a people that something is going to happen, something is coming, beware, take your heed and prepare for it. A people, ma unzira abawhum, whose fathers were not warned. Now, here we have a problem. Who are these people whose fathers were not warned? Why we say their fathers were not warned? Who do we mean by their fathers? Now, here there are different opinions. Allama Tawatabai Rahmatullah alayhi says that if the purport of the sentence alludes to Quraysh, then of course their immediate fathers were not warned. Otherwise, of course, they had the Prophet Ismail, many other prophets who came in that line, they warned them. And the warning came from other religions to them as well. So if Quraysh are meant, it's their immediate fathers. They were not warned. So they were negligent of this warning. If the whole humanity is meant by this verse, لِتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, whose fathers are not warned, then, of course, because after Jesus, no prophet came. And therefore, the fathers of all humanity, all people at that time, were not warned. So that would be the meaning of ma unzira abahum. Now there are other views. Qatada ibn Du'ama was one of the tabi'un who had good knowledge of tafsir, a contemporary of Hasan al-Basri. He believes that lam yunzira abahum means ma undara abahum, means that their fathers were in the fatra between Isa and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we have in Nahjul Balagha, that Amirul Mu'minin alayhi salam says, arsalahu ala hine fatratin min ar-rusul. Allah sends Prophet Muhammad when there was a lapse, there was a fatra, there was a stop, a halt in sending of messengers, because before, of course, messengers, prophets were coming one after another. Then there was a fatra, there was a halt. Arsalahu ala hina fatratan min ar-rusul. Now, Qatada says that yes, that fatra is meant here. Ma undara abahum means no one came between Isa and Muhammad, peace be upon him, to warn them. Now, Hasan al-Basri, another, of course, very prominent scholar of his time and scholar of the Quran, he says that, of course, we cannot say ma unzira abahum because there were Christians living nearby, Jews were living nearby, so they were warned in a way, but they were not warned in their own language. They were not warned by their own people. And this is very important because the Quran mentions in many places that the Arabs said that if a book comes to us, if a messenger comes forth from ourselves that we can understand, that we can read, and that we can recite, then we will be guided from the Jews, more guided from the Jews and Christians. Therefore, ma unzira abahum means they were not warned in their own language. Abahum, of course, before, after Ismail alayhi salam and others. You know, the Arabs, of course, in Mecca, they were descendants of Ismail. When Ismail was left in Mecca, he married a girl from Jurhum, a tribe who were living nearby. And then, of course, they became, the children of Ismail became Arabized. Ismail was not an Arab man himself. Ibrahim was not Arab himself. So they become Arabized. They were not called the pure Arabs. They were Arabized. And these people afterwards, of course, they didn't have any prophets. Now, there were certain people who believed that there were prophets or people like prophets between Jesus and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them was Qus ibn Sa'idah, and the other one was Khalid ibn Sinan. We cannot say that these were prophets, but they were very wise people. They were on the religion of Ibrahim. They were receiving some sort of revelation from God, these people say. And especially Qus ibn Sa'idah, he lived until the 30th year of Prophet's life. And Prophet had seen him. And Prophet did like him, of course. And he remembered that he was preaching in Uqaz, in Suq al-Uqaz, in the market called Uqaz. And when the Prophet, peace be on him, came to Mecca, he actually asked for him. And they said that he has passed away. And Prophet asked mercy for him. They said these people, of course, were prophets. And therefore, we cannot say that they were not warned. These people used to, especially Qus ibn Sa'd, they used to preach, used to call people towards God. However, they didn't have books. They didn't have missions. And therefore, لَتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ means they were not warned by big prophets like Prophet Jesus, like Prophet Moses. They were not warned. Prophet Jesus and Moses were sent to Banu Israel, not to these people, not to Arabs. And therefore, لَتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ is actually bringing to their attention a bounty from Allah, a real favor that, look, these people who were, of course, being humiliated by Banu Israel. You have no book, you have no prophet. Now Allah is guiding them and giving them warning. And inshallah, there is just a little bit of addition to this. We will continue with that first thing in our next episode. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi tahirin.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم اللهم صل على
أهل البيت TV, the holy household for every household.